Hey everyone, welcome to confirmation. My apologies that this lesson is a little bit later than I intended it to be. I got sick with strep and was kind of out of it for a few days, and kids got it, and life kind of happened. So this recording is a week late. But we still have plenty of time before our next class or our next meeting for you to watch the videos here. So I appreciate your patience as you, I'm sure, eagerly awaited this video to come out. Sorry. Couple quick announcements before we get started with class. For our Confirmation 1 students, our ninth graders, just a reminder of what we have left before the end of the year. So, after watching this video, there'll be some questions to reflect on below the video, and nothing you have to turn in or write anything down, but more just mental reflection to think about. Our next class is March 10th. From 6 to 7 p.m. here in the Pear Center. And then our year will end with a mini retreat on Palm Sunday, March 24th, here at Holy Family. It begins at 3 and ends at 7 p.m., and dinner will be included and everything. So that is what we have left for our ninth graders. For our Confirmation 2 students, our 10th graders, we are a few short weeks away from your confirmation. Super exciting. You should have received a link to sign up for a confirmation interview. We have some confirmation interviews coming up over the next 2 weeks or so. Nothing scary, just an opportunity for us to meet for 5, 10 minutes, and just talk about faith and life and confirmation and stuff before the big day. So please sign up for that if you haven't yet. We have our confirmation rehearsal on Thursday, March 7th. And then I know there is a concert, an orchestra or a strings concert of some sort that night at Duxbury High School. So if you are in one of the groups that is performing that night and can't make rehearsal, we're going to have a mini makeup rehearsal the following night, March 8th, on Friday night at 6 o'clock. There's stations in the church at 5:30. So if you want to come early and come to stations, you can, or we will follow them. If stations runs a little bit long, then we may start downstairs and then move upstairs after they are done in the church. But it'll be a quick rehearsal. So for the rehearsal, make sure you come with your sponsor or a parent stand-in, and we're gonna run through the ceremony and talk about some specifics that you need to know, and just kind of do that final preparation for the big day. And then confirmation itself is Saturday, March 9th, and we've got the two ceremonies at the 10:30 and 12. Hopefully you know which ceremony you are signed up for. If not, just shoot me an email and I can confirm which ceremony you are attending. And then arrival for that confirmation ceremony itself is half an hour early. So if you're in the 10:30 session, be here by 10. We'll meet downstairs at the Parish Center. If you are in the noon session, meet down here in the Parish Center at 11:30, please, and thank you. All right, all of that fun stuff is out of the way. So now we can get into class. Tonight, we are going to talk about who we are called to be. In the church, we use that term, the fancy term for that is, what is our vocation? What is God calling us to be, or who is God calling us to be? First and foremost, he's calling us to be a son or daughter of Christ, and to be the best version of ourselves. He wants us to love each other, to follow those commandments, to follow the Beatitudes, and live with the heart of Jesus, to love with his heart, to serve others, to help others, to spend some time in prayer with him, to serve our brothers and sisters. That is our primary vocation, to be that child of God that he made us to be, and we were called to be at our baptism, and we continue that journey through this confirmation process, you know, to be one with our brothers and sisters. So that's the primary vocation that we're all called to that love, that life, that Christian service, that brothers and sisters in Christ. We each all then have kind of our own ways that we can best fulfill that service, that vocation. And these are, you know, there's a couple traditional ones that we think of. First one that many of us are probably called to, I know I was, is the vocation of marriage, to live our life as a married couple, to bring children together, to love one another, and to share that joy of Christ in your marriages and in your lives and in your families. The second one that we think about a lot is religious life. So becoming a sister or a brother, you know, and dedicating your life to prayer or service, or depending on the, you know, the religious order you would join, you know, they each have their own call, they're each charism, you know, different ways that they live out their lives. Young people today are still becoming sisters and brothers. We don't necessarily hear about it all the time. And in our heads, sometimes when we think of nuns or sisters, we think of, you know, some of the older ladies that have been graciously and lovingly serving the church for many of years. But there are still young people today that are becoming sisters and brothers. Another vocation that we often think about, but don't always talk about, is the priesthood. You know, without priests, we don't have a church. Without priests, we don't have the sacraments. So I think, especially, you know, I'm passionate that it should be something that every young male, at least at some point, thinks about, prays about. You know, is this something that God might be calling me towards? I spent a year in the seminary, actively kind of thinking about that vocation, that discernment. That discernment, you know, didn't just last that year. It was probably about a 10-year discernment process, before I decided that I was being called towards the married life. And then another vocation that we'll talk about in just a second. But something that, you know, you should hopefully, you know, at least spend a little bit of time thinking about and praying about, because our church needs good young men to answer the call to become priests, to be those hands and feet of Christ in a very real way, to bring the sacraments to our brothers and sisters in Christ, and to continue on that mission of the church. So we'll talk about that. We'll talk very briefly about the diaconate. So that is a way that married men can serve the church in a different way. You get ordained to service. It's a sacrament of service to serve both at Mass at the altar, but also to serve the most vulnerable in our world and in our communities. And then finally, the last vocation we'll touch on briefly is the single life. Some people are called to live their life alone and not in like a sad, oh, I'm all alone kind of way, but live that authentic, joyful, single vocation. So for some of us, or for probably many of us, that single life will be a temporary vocation, as you journey to one of those others, whether it's married life or religious life or priesthood or whatever. But for some, we are called to that vocation of single life. So we'll talk briefly about that. So we've got a few different videos to show to talk about each of those vocations. The first one is an interview from a few years ago with a couple from church. They recorded a video for me to talk about kind of how they met, how their lives have changed through their marriage, and how they live out that vocation towards marriage. So let's listen to that and see what they have to say. So share my screen. So here we go.
Hi, I'm Paul.
And I'm Deborah.
And we're the Largozas from
Yes.
Kingston.
Kingston, Massachusetts.
And we're here to tell you about marriage
As a vocation.
and how we met and incorporate God into our lives.
I think that's a great topic.
So, how did we meet?
We met on Christian Mingle. I was in an airport in the middle of nowhere traveling for business, and this was back in what year? 2015?
2015.
In 2015. We got married later in life. The reason for me was because when I graduated from high school, like all of you guys will be in a few years, it was common for people to start dating and then get married. And I really just never felt like that was what I was supposed to do. And I prayed about it, and it just never happened for me. So I worked, and it's not like I was focusing only on my career, but it was really for me, I hadn't come to someone where I felt like I was to get married to them.
And I was never sure I wanted to get married. I was never 100% sure I want to get married my entire life almost. I just never felt a calling to settle down until a lot later in life. And once I got older, I kind of realized that the thing that was missing from my life was a consistent love of a wife or, someone to be there for me. And I dated on a lot of other sites, and I turned to Christian Mingle because it seemed that the people that I was meeting didn't have an affinity or closeness to God that I was looking for.
And I felt a lot of the same way as far as it was really important to me that when I decided I was ready to date, it was really important to me to make my relationship with God as the most important thing that had been with me up until that point in my life. It's very close, and I still am very close with my family. I wanted to really date someone who felt the same way, who would understand that I needed to have God be the center of my life, and eventually, when I would get married one day, I would want God to be the center of my marriage. And it's really, I think it's not something that's easy to find. Having God be the centerpiece of our relationship was really important. My siblings, I'm one of five children for my parents, and they all of my siblings got married. All of yours were married too. And they all had kids. And it kind of was like they were waiting for me to do that also, and it just never happened. And that was fine. I was fine with that. And it was really amazing when I went on to Christian Mingle. I put in what I was looking for someone, and he was brought up as a 100% match for me. And was I a match for you?
Sure.
100%?
Why not? Anyway, I was raised in a multiple religious household where my father was Catholic and my mother wasn't. Even though I was baptized Catholic, I never received the sacrament and gone through everything needed to be Catholic.
For me growing up, I was Lutheran. Both my parents were Lutheran, and I was baptized, did the sacraments, and I practiced going to church pretty much most of my life, but I felt like something was really missing for me. I really appreciated everything I was getting out of the Lutheran church, but I felt like for me personally in my relationship with God, I needed more than that. And so I started to go to the Catholic church up in Exeter, New Hampshire when I was living there. And it was around the time that we met each other. And in having us start talking and start dating, I had expressed to Paul that obviously my Christian relationship with God was really important to myself, but also finding a church that I liked. And I expressed to him my interest, and he agreed that we wanted to begin looking at going to the Catholic Church together.
We promised my parents, my father in particular, that one day we would have a Catholic ceremony and be married properly as Catholics. And that was fulfilled. We got married last year,
yeah.
By Father Tom.
In the small chapel.
At Holy Family. And even though we live in Kingston, we felt more of an affinity with Holy Family than any other place or any other church that we went to.
Last year, we went through RCIA together. And I think one of the important things, especially when you're in 10th grade, 11th grade, and you really begin, you know, you're dating and you have a lot going on with school and other things. One of the things that it's easy to kind of put on the back burner is going to church and participating in establishing yourself and your own relationship with God. And we both really felt like that we wanted to be part of a church where that could happen, where we could feel that we were building our own relationship. And when we went through marriage preparation classes, we did it in Brockton at St.
Joe's
Church in Brockton. And it was really an amazing experience for us to go through that together, because they really talked about the fact that marriage is a sacrament. And it really, for us, set the foundation of our relationship before we had our vows done in the Catholic Church, to really say that this is the foundation that we need to have in our lives to make our marriage successful. And I think it's really important because we've had a lot of things that we've gone through. So as we wrap up, I think it's really important. You're obviously hearing a vocation from a priest, the vocation from someone who's single, and you've heard from us and the vocation of our vocation of being married. And one of the things that's really important for all of you and where you're at right now is to really say, what is it that God wants for you in your life? And that's not always easy to know. And it can be kind of confusing. But I think it's really important that you know and understand that when you graduate from high school and you go about becoming an adult, going to college, going into your profession, whatever it is that you're being moved to do, it's important to really keep in mind that the vocation that God has for you is the right one for you. And for Paul, it wasn't getting married and doing that when he was younger, and same with me, it wasn't to get married and have children like I saw my family do. For me, it was really taking that time, devoting myself to God, doing my work. And then I feel like it prepared me so that when Paul came along and we got married, it really was the right time for that to happen. So we have time for a few questions, because I know that if we were there with you, you would be asking us some questions. And so one of the questions I know that I get on a regular basis is, what attracted me to Paul? And if you...
And for the record, it's pretty self-explanatory.
If you ask Paul, he will obviously tell you what's not to love.
Even
for me, what was really important is to obviously marry someone with a sense of humor, but it was also to have someone that really felt the same way about their relationship with God that I felt was with my relationship with God. But definitely having a sense of humor was really important. And I think for me, the other thing that was really important was when I read Paul's profile on Christian Mingle, it said that family was really important to him. And my family is extremely important to me. And so it was nice to see that he felt the same way. And that was definitely one of the things that attracted me
and
to him.
If you decide to write your profile on Christian Mingle or any website, a lot of exaggeration and lying really goes a long way. And you can, if you're really good at Photoshop, that really helps too. Because I don't have a six pack, but on my profile, ripped. So,
another question I think that we get a lot is,
I've never heard any of these questions before. Speaking of lying.
Another question that we get is, how did our family, how was it for us introducing each other, being older adults?
And mixed race.
And for me, it was really, my parents were just so happy that I finally had someone I was dating. And he's so awesome. They were like,
they all agreed.
But in all seriousness, it really was, my family was very welcoming for Paul, and when they met him, they could tell that we had a lot of things in common.
And once my family met Deb, they instantly and still liked her more than they liked me. So it's absolutely true. So you may not want to get someone like that. So,
it's because I get better Christmas presents.
All right, so that was just a little bit from kind of one couple here in the parish. As you heard, this was recorded a few years ago when we had a live vocation panel with a couple different people to share their stories. And they weren't able to make it, but they wanted to share their love and their vocation with our confirmation students. So recorded a video and then graciously said I could use that video whenever I wanted to. So this week when we were going to talk about vocations, I thought it was great to bring it back and just hear the joy that they have with each other and just the humor. Which, you know, I appreciate. I don't know if you guys always appreciate my dad jokes. I know my kids get sick of them after a while, and I'm sure you guys do as well. But Marriage is really meant to help each other and help your spouse get to heaven. To grow in holiness together, to grow in love together, and to spend forever with one another. When we say those vows, those I do's, we're pledging our lives to one another, and it's no longer about yourself, but it's about each other and the other person, and that life-giving, sacrificial love that Christ gave for us on the cross, is that same love that we give, sacrificial love that we give to our spouses in the sacrament of marriage. Hopefully it doesn't end in, a crucifixion, but it does at times end with dying to self, and sacrificing some things that you would do as a single person. Your time was your own and you could make your own choices and decisions, and kind of do whatever you wanted to do. Once you become a we and a couple, it becomes, kind of joint decisions, and your life is no longer your own, but you're part of a union. And sometimes that means you have less time to do certain things, because you're spending time with your spouse or growing together in holiness or whatever that is. So there's definitely some sacrificial love aspect to that sacrament, but it's beautiful and it's life-giving and it's holy. The next sacrament or the next vocation that we're going to talk about is to the religious life. We're going to watch a video clip here of a young sister, and it's not necessarily in the setting that you would expect. She was actually a contestant on The Voice, in Italy, and the judges were very surprised when they saw her, and it's just a great story. So we're going to watch a little clip of her initial performance on The Voice, and then kind of a follow-up report on her life after that, as we learn a little bit about being a religious sister and what that is about, and also just seeing how awesome it is that there are young people today still entering the religious life. Sharing my screen again.
Hi, I'm Paul.
Nope, we just watched that. So not exactly what so not exactly what you typically think of when you think of a religious sister. This was, probably now 10 years ago or so that she was on it, but she was 25 at the time, and she used her gifts and talents that God gave her, to, as she said in one of those back and forths with the interviews, to go out and evangelize and share God's love. And religious sisters have a lot of different charisms and different purposes to their orders. Some are teachers, some work in hospitals, some work in service to the poor, some reach in, outreach in different ways. There are so many different religious orders and religious communities that worship differently, that serve differently, but it's still something that young people are choosing to enter into, to to give their life to God in a different way. So just going to watch a quick little follow-up report on her to see a little bit more about her story rather than just her singing. And then we'll go to the next vocation. Share your screen.
Even though she's an unconventional singer, all of her videos have gone viral. Still, Italian nun Sister Cristina Scuccia says her singing is not about a question of showbiz.
Ovviamente sono prima una suora, poi una suora che canta.
Sister Cristina decided to take part in the Italian television show The Voice, which she eventually won. Her performances got all the attention right from the beginning.
Mi ricordo Ricky Martin che mi disse: "Guarda, sono venuto qui per te, no, per conoscerti." No, vabbè. No, beh, sicuramente comunque, cioè, il fatto che noi religiosi abbiamo raggiunto un luogo dove Dio spesso non entra, non esiste, sicuramente è stato un segno forte anche per gli autori stessi che tante volte venivano e ci ringraziavano per questo.
Months after her TV success, she released her first CD entitled Sister Cristina. It features her own personal cover of the Madonna hit Like a Virgin.
I made it through the wilderness. Somehow I made it through.
Ho letto che parla di una persona che all'inizio è sconfitta, desolata, ma nel momento in cui incontra l'amore, viene toccata dall'amore, la sua vita cambia. Ho detto, certo, anch'io posso raccontare questa storia d'amore con Dio, perché anch'io, il Signore, quando mi ha toccato, ha trasformato la mia vita.
Scuccia, better known as Soda Cristina in Italy, didn't like to pray when she was young. Music helped her find her vocation. Actually, she discovered that God called her when she played the role of a nun in a musical.
Lei era una ragazza che andava ad aiutare i poveri, i bisognosi, però a un certo punto si rende conto che da sola non ce la fa, non ci riesce, ha bisogno di altre ragazze. Allora va da altre ragazze e dice: tu avresti il coraggio di lasciare tutto per donare la tua vita a Cristo? Queste domande ritornavano poi nella vita di Cristina quando mi spogliavo delle vesti di Suor Rosa.
Sister Cristina plans to spend Christmas far from the flashes and interviews. She'll be back to her religious community, which will be surrounded by the very same nuns who more than a year ago encouraged her to go on stage.
La luce di Gesù bambino che nasce raggiunga i cuori di tutti voi. Buon Natale, vi auguro veramente di continuare sempre a sperare e mai perdere veramente la fiducia in Dio. Buon Natale!
Right. So yeah, so, you know, just, I love that, like, being able to go places where, you know, God usually isn't, or not that he isn't, but isn't, you know, on the forefront. You know, when we think of music, all the, like, reality TV shows, whether it's The Voice or Dance with the Stars, or I don't watch reality TV shows anymore. I'm not sure what is out there right now. Amazing Race, I don't know if that's still on, or if any of these are still on. But, you know, you don't typically think of, you know, a nun being on there, or, you know, talking about God or your faith or whatever. And these are all things that, because of her vocation, and because of the gifts that God gave her and her willingness to say yes and use those gifts and those talents, she was able to spread the love and hope and faith of Jesus Christ with a lot of different people. So before we watch the video on the priesthood, just wanted to take a second and talk a little bit about the diaconate. So when you receive the sacraments of holy orders, the first step in that process, the first sacrament of ordination that you receive, is that of the diaconate. Most of the time, that is taken as what's called a transitional deacon. So someone who is studied to become a priest and eventually become a priest, they get ordained a deacon first, and it's during a time of transition, and they spend a couple months, a year, 2 years, whatever it is, as a transitional deacon before getting ordained to the priesthood. And then the fullness of the sacrament of holy orders is being ordained a bishop. It was awesome. A few weeks ago, I was able to see our newest auxiliary bishop in the Archdiocese of Boston, Bishop Barboza, get ordained and become a bishop. And it was such a beautiful celebration of the worldwide church. He's from South America, and it was just a very just awesome, awesome celebration. There are since Vatican II, which is the church council that happened in the 60s that, you know, changed a bunch of stuff, you know, that we started having mass in English instead of Latin, and, you know, changed a whole lot of different things. One of the things that they reinstituted is instead of just the transitional deaconhood or diaconate, what is the permanent diaconate? So people who are ordained a deacon, not on their way towards priesthood, but are ordained a deacon to serve as the role of deacon. Deacons have been present from the early church. One of the first deacons was Saint Stephen, and they were called to help take care of widows and children and make sure that they were treated equally and equitably. And it's kind of that mission of a deacon that still continues today. A deacon is called to serve the church. They're called to serve the church at mass, at the liturgies, you know, reading the gospel and proclaiming God's word and assisting at the altar during the Eucharist. But more importantly, they're called to serve the people of God, and the poor and the sick and the marginalized and the forgotten about and the abandoned, and really help those that are in most need and most vulnerable. So we've got a couple deacons here in our church, some new ones and an older one, sorry, Deacon Art. So Deacon Art is a retired deacon, so you don't see him much on the altar anymore, but he is still around. He may have been some of y'all's bus driver when you were younger. He was a bus driver in town for a long time before he retired. And then we have two younger deacons, or more recently ordained deacons. Deacon Don LaRose was ordained in 2020. And Deacon David Cosgrove was ordained in 2022. And then I'm actually in my third year of formation for the diaconate, and God willing, will be ordained a deacon in the fall of next year. So I've got about a year and a half left in my journey. I'm excited for the process and excited for the opportunity to serve the church and serve the poor in a new and exciting way. So that's a little bit about the diaconate that's not talked about all that often. And then finally, the last vocation we're going to talk about is the sacrament or the vocation of the priesthood. As I mentioned in the opening, that the church still needs young holy men to enter the priesthood, to lead the church and to administer the sacraments and to shepherd the people of God. I spent kind of the last 3 years of my high school time, so it started my sophomore year in high school, thinking about the priesthood and discerning about it. And, I went back and forth and was gonna go to just a regular college. I got into Ohio State, had a full ride, actually to Ohio State to do finance and accounting. But then second semester of senior year, I decided that I didn't want to wait to kind of further explore this calling to see what God was calling me to do. I turned down my scholarship offer to Ohio State and entered the seminary, or applied to become a seminarian for the Diocese of Toledo, Ohio, where I was living, and got accepted and attended St. Joseph's College Seminary at Loyola, Chicago. For my freshman year of college. And my dad was not a fan of that at all. And he, even the day that we were moving me into college, Ohio State at the time was on quarters. So they didn't start school until end of September, beginning of October. Loyola was on semesters. So we were moving in the end of August. And he's like, there's still time to change your mind and go to Ohio State instead. And I'm like, no, like this is what I want to do. I want to explore it and figure it out. But he just wasn't a big fan of it. It was right around the time where, unfortunately, the clergy sexual abuse scandal was breaking kind of in Toledo. Out here in Boston, it had broke a few years prior. But it didn't kind of Toledo didn't come to light until later on. So there was a lot of hurt and a lot of questioning and just it wasn't, something that my dad really thought that I should be doing at the moment. But we moved into school and when we got there after we kind of set up the room and moved in, all the parents of the new seminarians went and met with the rector, who is the head of the seminary, and they had a meeting. Us seminarians had a meeting that we were going to, and then we met together for mass and dinner before the parents went home. And during mass, I could tell something was different. I didn't know what it was at the moment. And it took me until about halfway through mass to realize that my dad was singing. We had gone to mass together almost every week for 18 years of my life, and I don't think I'd ever heard him sing before. And he was singing. Like, this is strange. And then it came time for the sign of peace, and he gave me a hug, which was weird because he didn't hug people. And he was crying and he said, "I love you and I'm proud of you." All things my dad never did. And I'm like, what is going on here? What is happening? I expected my mom to be kind of little bit of a blubbering mess because her baby was going off to college and I was the youngest and the only boy. And so dropping me off in a strange town and leaving, like I expected my mom to be crying, and because that's what moms do. But I was not expecting it from my dad at all. And I'm just sitting there the rest of the mass, like, what is happening? Like, where did this come from? Later on, I found out that during the meeting with the rector, they watched this video that I'm about to show you. And it was through watching the video that my dad said, "I finally understand why Matt would want to potentially become a priest. I get it." And then, a couple weeks later, my dad got sick and collapsed at work and was diagnosed with cancer. And then, 6 weeks later after that, he passed away on November 2nd. So there's a lot of things that, we didn't get to talk about and explore further, but you know, this video always holds a close place in my heart, because it does, I think, encapsulate some of the beauty of the vocation of the priesthood and what it means to be a priest and the gift that that priesthood is to the world and the church and each other and to yourself. So I encourage any of our young males watching this to just spend a little bit of time and think about, you know, is this something that God might potentially be calling me towards? And then, you know, if it's not, or for our ladies, like, just spend some time just praying for our future priests, praying for our current priests, definitely, for Father Bob and Father Bill here at Holy Family, but all of our priests and, you know, all of our future priests, because it's not an easy vocation. None of the vocations are easy, but they are all super rewarding in their own different unique ways. So let's go ahead and I'll share my screen one more time and we can watch what's called Fishers of Men.
People want the challenge of being called to something more than just mediocrity. All young people, I think, have that deep desire to do something remarkable, to be someone remarkable.
We need good men who are considering the call to step forward and not be afraid.
Men willing to give of themselves, men willing to follow the call, to try to say, what is this something, this sense of a being led, being drawn into a service.
There are guys that are probably being called not hearing it.
Well, if we are priests of the Alter Christus, the other Christ, who else but ourselves should be going out and, like our Lord, saying, follow me?
And that one phrase has reverberated down through the centuries.
The priesthood or religious life is a supernatural call.
To lay down our lives so that others may have life.
So to put one's own desires, one's own will aside, say, Lord, what do you want? I will place anything on the altar of sacrifice.
We need men to give up their life for Jesus Christ. Yeah.
Priests that are out there, the louder the message will be.
It's not natural to be a priest, you know, it's supernatural.
So we've got to go out and fish. for the people. We've got to take up Jesus on his word. I'll make you fishers of men.
Vocation to the priesthood is countercultural.
Our present culture is a noisy culture. We're loaded with TV, music, we're loaded with sound, we never get rest. We've got the computer, and it's distraction, distraction, distractions.
Young people are entering into a society and into a culture not centered on God and on godly values.
The battles that the young people have to face in our society, drugs, immorality, the violence.
I think people are searching after God, but they're looking in the wrong places.
The greatest crisis right now in the world is the absence of God in our life.
World thinks of, you know, someone living celibate, you know, it mocks it, laughs at it, because their goal is do whatever you want, be free.
Many young people today are fighting battles which myself and older generations never had to fight.
If we have proper evangelization, then we have vocations.
Well, the church is important. The kids pick it up, like they pick up the language.
Who's going to give the sacraments for the next generation?
A culture and a culture affecting families lives further and further away from the Lord as the center of their life. It becomes harder and harder to hear that invitation and call from the Lord.
If you look at nature and the way things grow, they grow in silence. If you look at the trees and the flowers, if you look even at human beings, we grow in silence, you know, and a vocation is very similar. A relationship with God is very similar, and it grows in silence, in an environment where one's inner ears are open to hear God, who only speaks in silence.
The church was very important. There's daily mass in the family, at the rosary every night. It was just a strong Catholic family. I guess from the time I was very young, I wanted to be a priest. Never thought of anything else.
I was a professional baseball player for 8 years out of high school, which was a lot of fun for a kid from 18 to 26. And then I was a professional actor for the next 15 years. Well, not that I had great fame in either one, but I think I had a taste of enough of it to know how dangerous it can be. When I was ordained in 2000, my nose hit the marble, and I realized, my God, who am I to receive this gift?
It is an opportunity to stand for change and to effect change anywhere in the world, any part of the world. The Catholic priesthood is an instrument for the change that the world needs today.
I actually have a couple of friends that are joining the priesthood, and they're great people.
I think that they are important because they are like teachers for us.
I feel that they're just regular people who I can talk to whenever I have problems.
It should be just a normal part of every male Catholic to consider the vocation as far as becoming a priest.
We need priests because without the priests we won't have the Eucharist.
In a sense, they're role models that the youth can look up to.
The world needs heroes. John Paul II remains, in death as he did in life, the model priest, the mentor, the example, the one to answer, as he answered, the call of Christ, come follow me, and when you do it, do not be afraid.
He was such a brilliant light, just shining in the world. And he was shining for the world, but he also shined for us, for seminarians, for priests, because he taught us how to be a priest.
He was an actor, he was an athlete, he was good with people, he had a sense of humor, but with all these gifts, he gave it completely to God.
He set for us such an example that so many men were drawn to the seminary. Were encouraged, were given strength.
People saw a man who was living his life to the full,
He taught us that the priesthood was standing in the truth with love.
He was the face of the Catholic priesthood in our world, and what a beautiful face he really was.
I often think of John Paul II as a child. When his mother died, he went to a shrine and he said to the Blessed Mother, "You must be my mother now." And he carried that into his priesthood. And so every priest needs to re-echo his words of totus tuus, Maria. Because as Christ gave himself, his priesthood and his victimhood to the Blessed Mother, so every priest needs to give his priesthood and his victimhood to the Blessed Mother.
The works of the priest, besides being a counselor, besides being a spiritual leader, is someone who, as St. Paul would say, would administer the mysteries of God, that he is the one who brings the holy sacraments into the life of God's people.
When I say those words, "This is my body given for you," I almost get trembly, you know. Who am I to do this? What am I?
Have the sacred powers, powers from God, to call down the Holy Spirit on bread and wine.
And offering the blood of the Son of God to his Father. For mercy, calling down upon the world the mercy of the fathers, I raised that chalice, knowing that that chalice was filled with the blood that poured forth from his sacred heart.
I can honestly say that I really want nothing else in life but to bring people to Jesus Christ.
And each day, the gift becomes more beautiful and more brighter. It's a beautiful gift, the Holy Priesthood.
It speaks to the heart and the soul of every society and ministers to every human need. And wherever there is a human need, the Catholic priesthood is meaningful.
The priesthood is a life of sacrifice, it's a life of service, because it's the life of our Lord. And so it's not simply that of kneeling in the church all day and praying. It's rolling up one's sleeves and doing things for other people.
That sacrificial life, that have given their time, you know, completely to people, to hearing confessions, to saying Mass, giving retreats, and completely joyful doing it.
Quite frankly, a priest has to be all things to all people.
At the most important moment of their life, you walk in, a semi-stranger, but because you are a priest, you are part of their lives, you are part of their family.
You cry with some people, you laugh with others.
You know, what a person goes through in a lifetime, we can go through in a day. Because at one moment, you need to be rejoicing with the couple you're wedding. Another moment, you have to have that joy of bringing this child to baptism. At the next moment, you have to be preparing the soul for death.
Emergency, what is your location?
I'm on Route 135. There's been an accident on the southbound side near exit 16. There's a kid lying in the road. He's got blood on his head. He's not moving very much. He only looks like he's like a 17. So please, you gotta hurry, okay? Hurry.
Father James, can you hear me? It's the priest who brings the soul home to God.
May the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit come upon you and remain with you forever.
Sources on the ground, two young men have been taken to the hospital with injuries, while a third is feared dead after being thrown from his vehicle.
What draws young people to be priests is a priest's example, to be a father to them.
Because you are the face of Christ. And when they see you, they see the church. And when they see the church, they see Christ.
All young people, I think, have that deep desire to do something remarkable, to be someone remarkable.
Come, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men.
Our Lord told his apostles that they would become fishers of men. And so it is important that we accept that role and we go out and call people, perhaps even by name, individuals, and ask them if the Lord certainly is calling them to the holy priesthood.
We're talking about the sacrifices a priest has to make. When there's love, sacrifice is easy.
I really feel that in order for me to be who I was created to be, this is what I had to do.
Let people know how much God loves them, and that you're not there to dictate, you're not there to rule, but to serve. And I think that's the main point.
Like Jesus laying down his life for all of us, we lay down our lives.
The priesthood is tough, and it's for real men. You have to be a real man if you want to become a priest.
Guys, regular guys, to come and follow him.
When I came back to the Lord, that's where I found everything. That's where I found the treasure in the field. And it's worth selling everything to buy that field, to get that treasure, to get the pearl of great price hidden in that treasure box of the priesthood. You know, it's worth it all.
So each one of us are called. We're called to something more, to something greater. I encourage you to just start praying and asking God who you're called to be, what you're called to be, and how you can better listen to that call. Because each one of you is called to greatness. Each one of you is called to be the best version of yourself that you can be. Each one of you is called to be the hands and feet of Christ in our world. My prayer for each one of you is that God makes his call abundantly clear and known to you, and that you have the strength and the courage to follow that call. So we're going to end class here with just a quick prayer for vocations. So I'm going to share my screen one more time, and we can end class by praying this together. Don't forget the questions at the bottom to just reflect on and think about. You don't have to turn anything in or anything like that. But just reflect on them and think about them. And if you ever, want to talk about vocations and how you're feeling and what God may be calling you to, please don't hesitate to reach out to me or someone here at Holy Family. I'm glad to talk with you. All right, I'm going to share the prayer here. All right, so this is from the Year of Consecrated Life a few years back. It was a prayer for vocations. So we're going to pray this together. Let me zoom in a little bit. So this is Prayer of Consecrated Life 2015 with our Holy Father, Pope Francis. All right, together let's pray. In the name of the Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Amen. Lord of the harvest, bless young people with the gift of courage to respond to your call. Open their hearts to great ideas, to great things. Inspire all of your disciples to mutual love and giving. For vocations blossom in the good soil of faithful people. Instill those in religious life, parish ministries, and families with the confidence and grace to invite others to embrace the bold and noble path of a life consecrated to you. Unite us to Jesus through prayer and sacrament so that we may cooperate with you in building your reign of mercy and truth, of justice and peace. Amen. God bless everyone, and we will see you in class for our ninth graders on March 10th for our Confirmation 2 students at your confirmation interview coming up, and then at rehearsal on March 7th. God bless y'all. Have a great day.